I built a thing. It's an AI email assistant. It summarizes, sorts, archives, labels, deletes, and sends emails in and out of your inbox. And it has a personality. I don't know about you, but most of my email time is spent sifting through noise. So I built a thing that does it for me. In a split second. Also, writing emails is repetitive and people mostly just skim through them anyway. E-Manual, the email assistant, lets you skip that step of figuring out how to word things professionally. It's hooked up to the Gmail API and automatically ingests new messages. It'll pull all your emails in a matter of seconds. It's friendly, sleek, efficient, and fully customizable. In this video, I'll show you how to hook up your inbox to the Gmail API and walk you through how I built the bot. Lego.
So I'm just gonna say, hey, ask me if I wanna organize anything. I see here in my inbox, I have a lot of generic looking marketing emails from brands and stuff. You sort them into, so it's saying that it created a marketing label and it sorted 67 marketing emails into it. So I'm here in Gmail and I see that a lot of generic marketing emails have the marketing. Yeah, okay, and it found that email address. Just tell him you missed the way he smells. Cool, it says it sent the email. Hi, Ben, I missed the way you smell. Best, Benjamin, that's me. All right, so here we are in the Google Cloud Console, and I'm going to show you how to get that set up so that it could communicate with your Botpress bot. So the first thing we're gonna do is create a new project. Video demo. Now the project's been created. We're gonna go to that project. Now we have to enable the Gmail API. So we go to APIs and services, we look for that. This is the API that's gonna help us communicate with Gmail. We hit enable, done. All right, now we have to configure the OAuth consent screen. This is basically setting up a way to let Google know that the user who's using the application is the one who has permission to do so. So now here in APIs and services, we're gonna go down to OAuth consent screen. So the app here is called Gmail Agent, and I'm gonna pick my email address, set the app type to external, and I'm gonna set that same email address as the contact information. Frankly, this is for users to be able to get in touch with you if there's a problem, and this app is really only gonna be for personal use, so it doesn't really matter. Cool. Now we're going to go to data access and we're going to add the scopes we need. These are basically the different permissions we need to do the operations that we want to do in our application. Now I'll link you to the list of scopes, but what you can do is you can paste them here and they'll get found. What these scopes are generally are the different Gmail operations. So the big ones here are gmail.modify, gmail.read-only, and maybe gmail.send. Those ones I think are the only ones that get accessed in the application that I'm going to show you, but we just want to be able to look up things like contacts and user info. Cool. Update and save. Now we want to be able to create the credentials that we need to be able to access the application. Stuff like a client ID and a password to be able to tell Google when we make these requests, hey, I'm the client that has access to this application. It's just another layer of security. So what we're gonna do is create client. Application type is going to be web application. We're gonna call it Gmail client. And now under authorized redirect URIs, we're gonna put botpress.com. Okay, this is an indication that the OAuth client has been created. This is a client ID that we're going to need. There's also a client secret here. We're gonna need that as well. You're gonna wanna copy your client secret somewhere. I'm gonna copy the client ID just for good measure. You're going to need both the client ID and client secret when you access the Gmail API from a third-party application, like the one we're talking about. All right, now's the part where we create the PubSub topic. For those of you who don't know, PubSub is short for publish and subscribe. This is basically the operation where Gmail is going to publish or send emails, and there has to be some client who subscribes to them, which is our application, so that it's able to ingest those emails and process them. It's basically how it's going to update itself with our new emails in real time. So let's walk through how to do that. So we're here in the PubSub topics panel, and what we want to do is create a topic. I'm going to call this Gmail notifications. We're going to uncheck that. We have our own custom setup and hit create. And here we have our topic with our topic ID that's going to be important in the future. But for now, we need to give Gmail permission to publish. So we add principal, and the new principal is going to be the exact same service account email address that I'm putting in now, which is gmail.gservice-account.com. And it's already set. This is a default Google service account that will be able to push the emails from Google. And the role is going to be publisher. Save. Now we need to be able to receive those emails that are published, which means we have to create a service account. So we go to IAM and admin. And then we scroll down to service accounts. We hit create a service account. The name I'm going to give it is going to be PubSub push service account. And now for the role, we want to give it service account token creator. Right here, continue, and we're done. Okay, now we have to add the webhook integration to our bot. This is basically going to be a listener that's going to be able to accept the pub sub pushes. I'm gonna go to my bot. So in my bot, I'm going to go to Explore Hub, search for the webhook integration, click that, install the integration. Cool, it's installed. And that's important because now we have the webhook address, which is right here. That'll come back in a minute. So back in the console, we're going to go back to PubSub. This is the part where we create the subscription so that we can receive the webhook events. So we're gonna go over to subscriptions and hit create subscriptions. Now I'm gonna name this something generic, like the topic is going to be this topic we created earlier. The type is going to be push. And the endpoint, you guessed it, is going to be our webhook address. Now we hit enable authentication, use a service account, and it's going to be the service account we created. Now a couple of things that I'm going to configure is that I'm going to put never expire here. Now acknowledgement deadline, enter 60 seconds. And here under retry policy, retry after exponential back off delay. Minimum is going to be 60, the maximum I'm going to keep at 600, and hit create. And done, it's been created. All right, now what we have to do is authorize all the scopes and all of our tokens to be able to set up this webhook. How we do that is we take a URL, which I will share with you in the description, but this URL hits the Google OAuth endpoint, and we put in our client ID, our redirect URI, which in this case, if you remember, was the Botpress website, and it includes all the scopes that we want to validate. And then we follow a very regular OAuth flow. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna copy my client ID and my redirect URI. To find our client ID, recall we go to credentials, client ID, boom, client ID. And the redirect URI, as you recall, Botpress. We're gonna run this in the browser, see if we can follow the flow. All right, now it's going to validate all the different scopes I gave it access to, and then it's going to redirect us to Botpress. What we want to do is copy the code after the code key over here, and it's going to be all the text that's in between code and scope. Now that code we're going to need to be able to get an access token. I'm going to paste that somewhere safe. Now what we have to do is exchange that code for tokens. And you're going to need to do this every time you want to add a new scope. So for instance, you want to add user contacts or something, or you want to integrate calendar, you're going to have to run requests. And it could follow exactly this shape over here. I usually have my client ID, my client secret, and my redirect URI saved as environment variables inside my shell, but I just recreated them as you saw, so they're not doing that right now. So I'm actually going to copy all this and run it in the terminal. So I set all those environment variables. Now I'm going to run the curl command. What we're doing again is exchanging our access code, which we just received for authorization token. That token is going to be the thing that lets us make API calls to the Gmail API and do things like modify emails, check for emails, send emails, everything like that. Okay, it worked. This is awesome. So we have here our access token that will expire in an hour. You're going to have to refresh it pretty often. We have a refresh token. That's not going to expire. That's important. We're going to keep that in the bot. It has a list of the scopes, which is great. And then an ID token. This is just an internal Gmail thing. It's a JSON web token. Not important for our cases. I'm going to save the access token and the refresh token. Now is the part where we have to configure all of those credentials inside of our Botpress bot so that when we make API calls, we can authenticate our API call. I'm going to show you how to do that. In the bot over here, in the bot settings, I have a bunch of configuration variables. Now, I already set these because I already had this all set up. But since I changed it, I re-downloaded the webhook integration and it has a new webhook URL. I basically have to reset these all to the new values. Now, the access token isn't terribly important because as you'll see later, this bot has an authorization flow and it's going to refetch the access token because in all likelihood, by the time I start actually running this, it's going to be expired. But I'm going to put in the one I just got just for good measure. Now, the refresh token has to actually be the one that you just got. The client ID, we've worked with that a couple times already. I'm gonna put that in. Client secret, same thing. I hope you copied it. We're gonna go to get our pub sub topic. You know where that is, but just for fun, pub sub topics, topic name. That's what we have to copy. There you go. And for my email address, I just put in my email address. That's just something that I want the bot to have access to at all times. Maybe I shouldn't put it in the config. I might put it as a bot variable. It doesn't really matter. Cool. These are the new settings. I want to publish it so that it can actually ingest these sorts of messages. Great.
It's live.
Now what I want to do, just to test to see if it works, is send a test push notification, which is going to simulate essentially what's going to happen when we go through this webhook event trigger. So for now, I'm actually just going to log the webhook event. So we grab the data key, then we output that to a string, and we share the decoded buffer. Done. We're going to publish that again. Topics, messages, publish a message. Check our logs. Oof. Body message. Okay, wrong thing. Payload message. Let's hope that works. Payload body. Publish that again. And send another message. All right, let's see what's up. Okay, and we have the code here that we logged to the console. Test true. That's what we sent. Everything works. So that's it. I mean, that's it. It's a lot, but that's how you get Google set up to communicate with one of your Botpress bots. I'll meet you in the studio to talk about how the bot works. All right, so let's have a look here at how the bot works. So I'm just gonna say, hey, ask me if I wanna organize anything. I see here in my inbox, I have a lot of generic looking marketing emails from brands and stuff. Let's see if we can like sort them. Generic marketing emails. Okay, so it pulled up a few of them. You sort them into... So it's saying that it created a marketing label and it sorted 67 marketing emails into it. Let's see what happened and if that worked. So I'm here in Gmail and I see that a lot of generic marketing emails have the marketing label. Can you send an email to Ben, by the way? Yeah, okay, and it found that email address. Just tell him you missed the way he smells. Cool, it says it sent the email. Hi, Ben, I missed the way you smell. Best, Benjamin, that's me. Let's have a look at how this bot works now. Okay, so it gives you a little breakdown of the things that are going on in your inbox. You'll notice there are a whole bunch of different steps that get run. So first of all, when I start, I have this one node called maybe setup watch, and usually I have it plugged in. This is better for deployment, but in the emulator, all of my variables get rewritten every time I do that. So we go straight to this node here that collects today's date. And once we do that, we go to the autonomous node. We have all these instructions. I'll have this posted somewhere online. But what's going on here is that we give it access to a couple different tools. The important ones are these. The knowledge base, for starters. This knowledge base just basically has the Google API documentation. In addition to the knowledge base, it has access to the messages table. The messages table stores copies of the emails that I have. It has information like the subject, the content, and the labels. And finally, it has access to this API over here. What this flow does is it calls the Google API and it asks for basic API variables. So the method, the URL, the query parameters. When I make an API call, it goes to this API flow and it determines all these parameters by itself, whatever's appropriate. If it doesn't know which parameters to use, it can check again in the knowledge base. We log the data, then we check whether or not the bot's token expired. This is the access token that we talked about before for auth. We call this auth workflow. It does that same operation we did earlier in the terminal where we got a new access token. So if we don't have a token or the token's expired, then we call auth. If not, then we go straight to the next card. Either way, we go to that card. So you can see over here in my logs, we went to API. Obviously, because we restarted the conversation and in the emulator, all of the variables get deleted every time, we called the API and then the API determined that we didn't have that variable. So we went to auth. We got the new token and then we resumed API and we made the API call. Execute API request with error handling and logging, which is right here. It's this card over here. It's a regular API call that just adds the parameters. It writes the response to this object workflow.response and then exits the workflow with that variable so that the autonomous node can also look at the result. We log the parameters we do the API call with so that they're always visible over here. And you'll notice the bot basically always gets the URL right. And I've just about never had problems with parameters of data because they're made so explicit in the knowledge base. These are scraped from this documentation, which is very clear. API documentation generally, I think, is very easy for LLMs to follow. Now, this is great, and this works for basically all the API calls, like this one over here, where I asked it what labels we have. This is a pretty generic one. It just hit the labels endpoint. It didn't have any parameters. And then the result that we got back is that, all the labels. As we saw before, we're able to get the summary of my inbox. So how is it getting messages to my inbox? We have this initial seed flow. What you're gonna wanna do when you first set up this bot is seed it with the information from your email. So we basically store a copy of them inside of this messages table. How that works is we basically make an API call and we grab users.messages. What that returns is message objects, but all they have is an ID and a thread ID. Basically the data that we see here in the table is not going to be in that response. So we actually have to fetch each one of those messages one at a time, which is an incredibly resource intensive operation if you do them actually one at a time in a loop. So instead, I take all those message IDs and I run the fetch and save messages flow. Now the fetch and save messages flow does basically the same thing as any other API call, except it runs them in parallel. And then once it grabs all those emails, it upserts them into the table. Now, when does it get seeded? Well, one of the options is you could just seed it manually at the beginning and then you have it ready. After that, you have a listener set up for incoming events. We'll talk about that in a second. The other option is what I've been doing before, which is maybe set up watch, which is anytime there's an incoming message, you check whether or not the bot has the history ID and the watch expires at. Now, if it doesn't have those variables, it means that it's not being set up or the watch token has expired. So you set up watch, and then once you set up watch, you seed it with all your data. You're making the assumption that if watch isn't set up, there might be some emails that you missed, so you might as well fill in the gaps. So how do we continue maintaining our inbox in real time? Every time Google sends a push notification that hits our webhook URL, it comes in through this event, goes to the handle webhook event flow. Now, what does this flow do? First, we set up watch if it doesn't exist already. I talked about this before. And then what we do, this might be a little bit naive, we seed our messages table with all the data that it gathers from Gmail account. When we do that seed, what we do is we grab messages. If we don't give any parameters, it'll grab 100 messages with a next page token. I'm not using the pagination right now for the sake of doing a demonstration. I didn't think it mattered that much. What we do is we collect those emails. We fetch them in this parallelized fetching flow that I showed you before. So that's how setup watch works. If we don't have the history token or the watch token, then we set up watch, we seed our database, and then we exit. When we get a webhook event, it has a whole bunch of data in it that includes the history ID, which we need to fetch the changes that happened over time, and stuff like publish time, as well as the messages that were affected. And what we do is we call a special Gmail API endpoint, which is history. And it basically gives you an appraisal of all the different items that have been changed since the time that you acquired the last history ID. Basically means since the last time you look for updates, what has changed. Now, if we just seeded the database, then the history will not have been that long. But in most cases, this won't be running because the bot stores one of those history IDs and it keeps watch for, I think by default, a week, but it possibly never expires if we set that variable. So then what we do is we go through the object of the changed information. So it takes all those messages that have been updated, and then we run this flow over here again, the fetch and save messages. Now this time, instead of grabbing everything in the inbox, which is what happens at the initial seed workflow, when handle webhook events calls this workflow, what it does is that it only operates on the messages that have just recently come in, which if we just ran the initial seed, then there's not going to be a lot of messages that have come in since like 2 seconds ago. That is how everything works. Just to give you a little recap, when we get a webhook event, we call this handle webhook event flow, and it maybe sets up watch if that hasn't happened yet. Then it takes the pub/sub push message that we just got. We grab the history, users me history, and then we take all the messages and we fetch and save them to our messages table. Now, when I as a user start a conversation, first it calls maybe setup watch, which is gonna check whether or not we might be missing emails. Then it retrieves a current date because that helps with the prompting. And that is when we hit our conversational autonomous node. This is where we stay for basically the whole conversation. Sometimes we call the API when I ask it to do a thing that requires the API, like send a message or add a label to this message or remove a label from this message. If it needs to know how to make that API call, it searches the knowledge base that has the API documentation. And if it needs to check anything about what's already going on in the inbox, instead of fetching emails from the Gmail API, it's much more efficient and more reliable to get them from our messages table. So that's it. That is start to finish how this AI email assistant works. All right, let's talk about features you can add to expand on this. One, Google Contacts access. A more reliable way to search for email addresses would be to go through your Google Contacts. This lets you cross-reference names and email addresses in a more compact and structured format instead of having to look through the messages table. I should have done this, I was just lazy. Two, filtering incoming messages. Triage incoming messages and categorize them appropriately. You can hold a table of your existing label categories or go through your messages and determine which kinds of messages are associated with which labels. It's like a multi-shot prompting problem. There's some engineering to be done to make that run smoothly. Maybe I'll make a video about it. Maybe not. Three, an unsubscribe function. LLMs are pretty good at tracking down unsubscribed email addresses from emails. You'll have to pull the full message data to find the link, but the rest should be straightforward. All the infrastructure's there to grab, read, and send emails. You'll just have to play around with the system prompt to get that to work. All right, that's all my ideas. Go make $50,000 a month selling this. Bye.